mean, who's on extra this? These guys really have done quite a bit for us. And as you know, Diane started serving, and she ended up becoming an employee because she was served away to a paycheck. And Don is here every morning, first one here, last one to leave every morning. All of this, well, that's just, you know, all this. Looks pretty spiffy, though, doesn't it? So those are our three deacons, and we'll probably be appointing more in the coming year. Yes, we'll be talking about that in our elders. So deacons, you guys can, go back to the deacons. I'll show you what that is in a moment, but Erwin Lutzen said this: the judgment seat of Christ is, to our shame, almost universally ignored among Christians. Most of whom I talk to this end Christ died, verse 9, and it lived again, that he might be Lord unto both the dead and the living. Remember when we talked about judging last week, why we not judge not lest you be judged. This is still the same theme. Why do you pass judgment on your brother? Or why do you despise your brother? For we all will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess to God. So then each of us will give an account of himself to God. It's you and I. So we give an account of ourselves, not of others. So I stand before God, I can't go, well, I did because... No, there's not going to be any vertical point there at all. And there's not going to be any real, God will know exactly why. And I may even convince myself of a few lies, but God will shortly cut through those. In fact, I think our own self-deception, self-lies will evaporate the moment we enter into eternity. I think we'll know exactly why we did what we did, and there won't be another person attached to it. Therefore, in light of this, verse 13, let us not pass judgment on one another any longer, but rather decide never to put a stumbling block or a hindrance in the way of a brother. Remember we told you last week about how some people would eat meat sacrificed to idols, and that was a big issue back then. We have our own issues today. I'll probably mention them in a few moments. I know that I'm persuaded in the Lord Jesus that nothing is unclean in itself, but it is unclean for anyone thinks that it's unclean. It's quite a verse. So nothing is really unclean in itself. The meat sacrificed to idols isn't unclean in itself, but it's unclean to the person who thinks it's unclean. So for this person, they may think, that's not unclean. That's not unclean. This person said, that's unclean. I would never do that in a million years. Which one's right? But they both are, in a sense. And because, to the pure, all things are what? So, for if your brother is grieved by what you eat, you are no longer walking in love. By what you eat, do not destroy the one for whom Christ has died. So if I'm doing something that's causing my brother to stumble, or to judge me, or to get confused, or I'm confusing them, then it's better for me no longer, if I'm walking in love and I really care about them, I will give up my liberty for the sake of my brother. I don't hang on to it and say, I can do this, it's not wrong. Well, if my brother thinks it's wrong, or if it could cause my brother to stumble, I willingly give it up. Because a liberty is just that, it's a liberty. And it's not worth my brother's soul. And it's not worth my brother judging me. And it's not worth my brother stumbling. It's just not worth it. If I'm hanging on to my liberty that much, to the expense of other people, it's probably not a liberty, it's probably a provision for my flesh. So this is good scripture. So do not let what you regard as good to be spoken of as evil. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Go, Paul. I love him. Whoever thus serves Christ is acceptable to God and approved by men. So let us pursue what makes peace and for mutual upbuilding. Do not, for the sake of food, destroy the work of God and take food out of there and put in something else in there. Fill in whatever it is today that's causing believers to divide. Everything is indeed clean, but it is wrong for anyone to make another stumble by what he eats. It is good not to eat meat or drink wine or do anything that causes your brother to stumble. We may not know, this is important, we may not know what will cause a brother to stumble. What causes me to stumble might be something totally different would cause you to stumble. Here's the trick there, I don't know. So I've got to be careful that my lifestyle and the liberties that I take for myself is not a liberty that you might not have that liberty, and I certainly don't want to be your there was a Spurgeon that used to smoke cigars, and I think they used him as an example to smoke cigars, and he realized, it's not, no one my name attached to cigar smoking, because it taught other people to stumble. So again, what's a liberty for me might not be a liberty for others. The faith that you have, keep between yourself and God. That's good wisdom there, isn't it? Blessed is the one who has no reason to pass judgment on himself for what he approves. Now, whoever has doubts is condemned if he eats. But whoever has doubts is condemned if he eats, because the eating is not from faith, and whatever does not proceed from faith is sin. So, with that in mind, to the pure, all things are pure, Titus 1:15. Remember verse 8, the last chapter? O man, nothing but to what? Love them. We're not making issues out of what aren't issues. Many of us make issues over things that God doesn't really care about. I'm shocked at the banners that some Christians will raise and battles they want to fight when the Bible is being attacked around the world and people are, what's the word I'm looking at, deconstructing their faith. That should send shudders down our spine that people are doing that, and we're arguing about these peripheral doctrines. How about this modern meat category? Vaccinate or not to vaccinate? That is the question. I'm being funny, but it divided the church. Not this church, and not all churches, but it caused division amongst families, it caused division amongst churches, it caused division amongst believers, which was an individual issue between an individual and God. And it's not about anyone else's business. Now, we will face judgment as believers. But those aren't the issues we're going to face judgment on. It's going to be something different than that. Now, with that said, let's look at one of the other primary passages. Yvonne already read a portion of this. We have to read the verses. Oftentimes, the verses we read on Sunday morning will be the peripheral verses to the things that we're speaking on, if there is other verses out there. So let's read 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Yes, we are fully confident that we'd rather be away from these earthly bodies, for then we will be home with the Lord. But whether we are here in this body or away from this body, our goal is to please Him. Watch this. For this is where we want that. For we must, what's the next word? All stand before Christ to be judged. And we'll receive whatever we deserve for the good or evil we have done in this earthly body. Because we understand our faithful responsibility to the Lord, we work hard to dissuade others. We know, God knows we're sincere, and I hope you know this as well. So it says, we will all stand before Christ to be judged. Now this particular judgment is not what we would, you know, in Scripture, we know that it's not the white throne judgment. That's the judgment of eternal destiny. This is the judgment of rewards that's really given to the church, as you and I. This is everyone here. We will all face this judgment. It's thema. And it's placed in the Greek word thema. I mean, it's called the thema seat. Sounds like a car. Actually, that's the demur. Demur seat. Person in the competition, the winners of competition. That would be a picture of the bema. They'd come before the judgment, and the judge would award the wreath or whatever the reward was for what they did. So it's judgment. It's not the same as we see in Revelation 21. It's a judgment for the church. There'll be no unsaved people at this judgment. Your eternal destiny will not be in question. That will be, that determined the moment you ask Christ into your heart. time of the beam receipt, it's debated. I believe it happens right after the rapture of the church, that's my belief. Not all will believe in me, they don't realize how right I am. But I don't want to cause them to stumble, so I will make a big issue about it. I'm just kidding. Now, some put the beam receipt after the tribulation period, and, along with the marriage supper of the Lamb, some of these end time events. It's when it is not that relevant to me. The fact it's coming is relevant to me. The fact that it's a reality, it's taught thoroughly in the scriptures, that's what makes it important. It's not important when it happens, it's important that we will all be there. And it can't be avoided. At the deepest deep, there'll be no secrets, there'll be no do-overs. The quality of our eternity will now be framed by the results of this judgment. I may even speak on this next week, because I have a lot more to say than I'm getting it out this morning. It amazes me sometimes how many people live secret lives with secret sin and gross mispriorities without much or any thought of eternal ramifications. Doesn't shock me about secret lives and secret sin, because that's been going on since the inception of the church. But, and I understand, people battle with weaknesses. People may have a secret besetting sin, Hebrews 12, 1 and 2, that they struggle with throughout their lives. I get that.
Right.
But to pretend like it doesn't exist between you and God, you may not want to tell man, because you don't trust man and how man will treat you, and I get that. I don't blame you. But understand this, it's you and God. It's you and Jesus. You can trust him. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him and live an absolutely perfect life should never perish. No. Whoever believes in him. If man could be perfect, even remotely perfect, would Jesus have to have died? There is nothing righteous in man that would cause God to say, wow, this is a good one.
Yeah.
No, he had one, we're short of faith in one area, we're literally, my friends, we can be condemned because nothing but perfect perfection can come into the presence of God. God is absolutely holy, absolutely righteous, and absolutely perfect. So for us to live with Christ in heaven and have fellowship with him and be body of Christ, we have to be the same way. That's not going to happen behaviorally this side of heaven, but it happens positionally. The moment we ask Christ to be our Savior, he seals us with his Holy Spirit and imputes not my righteousness, I ain't got none. He imputes Christ's righteousness to us. That's why the gospel is glorious. Now this matters. And when I talk to folks about this through the years, they say, I don't know about that beam, I just want to get there. I just hope I make it. I don't care about rewards, I just hope I make it. You will care. I trust me, you will care. This is a big deal. This is not a little. God's going to say, hey, yeah, come on in. Yes, I know you don't care. You just like swim on the carpet. Get in here. Get in here. Pull you into the door. Now, do I think you're going to be regretful for all eternity? No. Do I think you're going to be kicking cans down the streets of heaven? No, I don't think that. I think heaven's going to be so glorious and so magnificent for all of us. So how does this reward thing work? Not quite sure I know. But I know the Bible teaches it really clearly. And so we're going to look at that a little bit. We want to do more than just get there. Whatever things we're hanging on to here, especially the things that we know we can give up if we need to. Missed priorities, whatever. We know we can give it up. We hang on to it. It doesn't bring glory to God.
Christ Jesus for what? Good works that God has prepared beforehand, that we should walk in them. So God has a list of good works for Tim Kelley to perform in the course of my life. And he's gifted me with a certain gift set to perform these good works, put me in the environment where these good works come to pass. That's just for me. It's different for you. It could be just raising this beautiful family, or being a wife, or being a dad, and a businessman, or whatever it is. But God foreknew before the foundations of the world that Tim Kelley, this is the good works I have for him. This is the plan I have for his life. For God, Hebrews 6:10, for God is not unjust. He will not forget how hard you have worked for him and how you have shown your love to him by caring for other believers as you still do. See, our works and all their diverseness, different for every Christian, they'll follow us to the Bema Seat. They'll reach into eternity. The people we reach that we don't even know that we've reached, the missionary money we've given that are reaching children in third world countries, we don't even know, we'll never meet these people. I was talking with my wife and Megan last night, and we were talking about the nursing home ministry for years. And for years we went to the nursing homes. I remember, guys, remember Swan Home Nursing Home? Anyone remember that? It used to be big right on Central Avenue. And we used to go in there and meet my wife and I for a whole decade. We'd go in there. And there's one dear woman with cerebral palsy, and she was probably in her 30s. She could not speak. She was crumpled up into a little ball in her bed, and couldn't move, and she was bed, had to be hand-fed. And we'd go in every week, and we'd visit her. My wife would sit by her bed and read her the Bible. And as we read her the Bible, she would begin stretching, and she'd begin moving, and trying to communicate, and asking to keep reading, and things like that. And then every week we did that. And then one day we were walking out, and it was the nurses came up to us and said, "We want you to know that that's the biggest response we get from her all week long. Just when you come in, just 15 or 20 minutes, you just read this woman the Bible." Think that's written down in heaven? Think that God knows about that and somehow that made it into the sheet? It was just simple for us. But it meant everything to the soul. To the soul. That came back to memory after 25 years last night. Philip Blankon. Ever hear him? I didn't hear him yesterday. There's four different ways going down his name online. So I just grabbed the one my boss mentioned to be the best. This was Martin Luther's right-hand man. He worked with Martin Luther. He said that we teach that good works are meritorious, not for the forgiveness of sins, grace, nor justification, for we obtain these only by faith, but for other physical and spiritual rewards in this life, and in which I yet to come. Therefore, there will be different rewards and different labors. There'll be distinctions in the glory of the saints. There'll be distinctions in our glory. So we'll be judged according to our good works, evil, kakos, or good, kalos. So it's just a distinction. So what I do here impacts my eternity. And if I can use this term, the quality of my eternity. Now what does that mean? I don't really understand how it manifests, but the Bible's teaching us this, that the things I invest in now and the eternal things I put in now has an impact on what my eternal experience will be like. Does that mean I'm going to shine more? I don't know. Am I going to walk on the streets of gold and go, "Oh, that guy's shining. That's really shining." I don't know. Do I have a deeper consciousness of Christ in heaven? Maybe. I don't know. We're going to talk about crowns, the different five crowns of the scriptures? Do I actually get crowns? No, Alden wants them.
Keep your crowns away from them. Even in heaven, you don't know what's going to happen.
I'm not sure how the crown of glory really looks, or the crown of righteousness, or the crown of life, or the crown, incorruptible crown. I'm not sure, but he says we're rewarded with those things. It says we're rewarded with a special gate in 2 Peter 1:11-12, an entrance, and the grand entrance. He's talking about these are some of the things we're rewarded with. I don't know what that looks like, but I see the promise in the scriptures. What does it mean when we lay up treasures in heaven in Matthew 6:1? What's Jesus talking about? I'm laying up treasures in heaven. That's how I'm living my life now. My values, my priorities, the things I invest my life into, people I invest my life into, giving to a cause that God wants me to give to. I'm laying up treasures in heaven. God doesn't forget any of those things and rewards us for everything. So it is important. You know, it's more than just getting there. It's God has this entire plan for his children for all eternity. Maybe we'll see this next week. But our thoughts and our intentions are judged. That's a rough one. Hebrews 4:12-13. That's when I had to come to grips with as a young man, because I thought just for my outward sin for him to be judged. Well, good old willpower can sometimes take care of your outward sins. Good old willpower sometimes just get too old to sin. It's too tired. And so I'm not in good enough shape to sin anymore. But inside, God started showing me my inside stuff. Wow. I have a wrong motive here, a wrong motive here, I have a wrong motive here. I'm selfish in my marriage. I'm all this corruption inside of me. And I realized that. I remember crawling out sometimes hearing a message priest thinking, is there any hope for me? And the answer was really no. It wasn't. My hope was in the grace of God and the mercy of God. That was my hope. There was no hope in Tim, because as soon as I got rid of those things, I found new stuff. God's like, the word of God's like that little metal detector on the beach. All of a sudden, you find somebody's lost penny, something like that. And it's that's what the word of God does. It goes through our soul. Beep, 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 beep. Wrong motive, wrong intention. You did this, yes, this is the wound for God. And that happens right up until I go to heaven. Words are judged. Wow. In Matthew 12:36, should we judge by a word? Motives are judged. 1 Corinthians 4:3-5. Won't go much longer here. A.J. Gordon said this: I cannot think of a final divine reckoning which shall assign the same rank and glory to the degree of joy to a lazy, indolent, and unfruitful Christian as to an ardent, self-denying Christian. Tim Kelley did not say that. A.J. Gordon said that. Didn't bring it up again. Earl Armacher says, the person I am become today is preparing me for the person I shall be for all eternity. See, only in this life can I impact my eternity. I'm not saying you're talking about somewhere I'll spend eternity. We understand that's based in the blood of Christ and the sacrifice on the cross. But I can impact my eternity by how I spend this life, my values, my
gotten a privilege to that I will go to my grave with, and not quickly repeated for the first eager years of, don't tell anyone, but. No, I go to my grave with it, because I'm letting that person think of me. And if God can cover this and forgive this, then I can certainly not talk about it. God remembers that stuff. I got a long quote here, and we'll wrap it up. Eric Sauer and his Sawyer, I guess I have said, the Triumph of Crucified, he wrote a really good, the best long sacrifice I've seen on the description of I think the Judas. I'm not going to read the verse because it'll be on the screen. I'm just going to read what he said. This is talking about how the Christian will be judged. The standard is our faithfulness, the sum total of our life, the product of our development, not only our deeds, but also our possibilities. Not only what we were, but what we might have become. Not only our actions, but also our omissions. Not the work, but the worker. Not the number, but the weight of our deeds. Not how many we do. Not only what we attain, but also what we strove after. For our works, sacrifice matters the most. Of our disposition, only selfless love. Of our possessions, only what we employ in service. As to our sins, this world applies, but what he has judged, he will not judge again. It's a great sentence. He's already judged our sin. He's not going to judge that again. He's not going to, but the Bible says, not about me going up saying, you tend to still do this, you still do that, you still do this, you did this, sin, you did that, sin, you did this, sin, this, sin. Now, what am I going to say? Is that, then who got more? Did all of them have more sins, or did I have more sins? I know you're going to win that battle. it's not about that at all. It's not going to be about my weaknesses. It's going to be, am I in the race? Am I in the battle? Am I in the trenches? Am my values right? Is my priorities right? Am I doing the very best I can to bring glory to God with my life? That's what we'll be judged on. For what we have uncovered, he will cover. What we have covered, he will uncover. In everything, he will take note of the most inward elements of the impulses and the motives and the counsels of the heart and the secrets of the souls hidden in doctrine. See, this doctrine was a life changer for me. I went through a personal thing. I've shared this story a dozen times, but it was one of my covenant moments with God, my Shechem moment, if I could use that term, where it changed my life and how I viewed my approach life differently. It was in 1994. I was pastoring this church, and I was going through a personal crisis in the ministry we were part of back then, and I was deeply, deeply troubled. I didn't feel as though I had one person I could talk to. I don't think I did have one person I could talk to. And then as I was wrestling with God, this went on for a good part of a year, 9-10 months. I was wrestling with God, and God convicted me and said, you know, Tim, the problem you have is you put faith in man, and not necessarily in me. You've expected man to affirm you. You've expected man to appreciate you. You've expected man to acknowledge you. That's your bad. That's not the man's bad. So I repented. Prayed to God. I was alone in my office. I repented. And then the Spirit of God said to me, live your life. Stand before me. So live your life for that. Live your life to stand before me at this judgment, this BMC judgment. Live your marriage life, your money life, your private life, your secret life, your mouth life, your ministry life, your pulpit life, what you watch on the screen life. Live that life to stand before me. I was trying to get from man and not get it from God. And when I repented of that and realized I'm going to live my life now to stand for this moment, I'm going to be a husband. I'm going to fail as a husband for this moment. I'm going to live my relationships with family and loved ones and church life for this moment. I'm going to take my money and manage it for this moment. I'm going to look at world missions, home missions, people, my time, my schedule, my calendar for this moment. The moment when I can stand before God and be judged for what I've done with the time He's given me on earth. This can keep you really focused. Mm-hmm. And it can take a lot of pressure off. Trust me. Because I have an audience of one. And if I just live for the audience of one, it takes care of all the other audiences in my life. None of those really matter because I know I'm okay with the audience of one. If I mess up on the horizontal, I fix it best I can as the audience of one would have me. And then I move on. Because this is the day of days, where we'll stand and God will acknowledge everything we spent, every bit of sweat, every bit of heartache, every bit of clamoring, every bit of grief, trauma, all those things. God brings it all to life. Psalm 58, verse 11, mankind will say, surely there's a reward for the righteous. Surely there's a God who judges on earth. Jesus, thank you for these precious people here today. Thank you for the worship we've had. Thank you for the elders and deacons and the great work they've done for this local assembly. Thank you for the precious people here, those online, those on Facebook. Father, we just pray that you would bless those listening today, and that this message would impact and touch them like I know it did me, in just delivering it, preparing for it, reflecting on it. Every head bowed and every eye closed. If you're listening maybe on Facebook, and you're listening on YouTube, or wherever you may hear this, maybe it's 2026, 3 years from now, you happen to find this on YouTube, and you just happen to listen to this particular message. Listen, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should never perish, but have everlasting life. Whosoever, beautiful word, means that God reaches down. We shared a funeral this past week. He reaches down, and all you're going to do is reach up. He's proposed to the human race. He wants relationship with you. Don't let the world and the media reduce Christianity down to a bunch of moral do's and don'ts, behavior modification. That's not Christianity. Christianity is the God of the universe having a personal relationship with His creation, man. If you have never asked Jesus Christ to be your Savior, it's a good opportunity.